as per the your examination pattern is considered, you have the option between projection of lines and planes. So as far as possible from my side, I'll do my all varieties of the problems from the planes side. Planes. So because around 50 to 60% of the problems are covered, but remaining 40% of the problem I'm going to cover in this week as well as next week. Then projection of solid, no other option. You have to completely study the projection of solid. There is no choice for the projection of solid. That second question is on the projection of solid. It carries around maximum mark. It is around, carries around 40 marks. So out of 40 marks, around 25 marks for the sketching, another 15 marks for doing it on the system. Again, in the case of the projection of planes also, maximum mark is for sketching. If sketching is correct, then definitely if you do it at the system, you get the full marks. But if sketching itself is wrong, then if you do the wrong problem in the solid dead software also, you don't get the marks. That's why the understanding the problems and doing it on the sketchbook, that is important. It carries more than 60 to 70% of the marks. That is, first question is, you have the option between lines as well as planes. So lines, there are many varieties, and every time you may have some confusion. The planes are easy chapter. The first, I will finish all varieties of the problems from the planes. Then at the end, if you have some time, I'll do some more problems from the lines also, I'm going to finish. Now, the solids, no other option. You have to study all the varieties of the problems. As by my knowledge is considered, all varieties of the problems are already dealt. All varieties, you don't think it's 1, 2 problem number 50. So that means once you've done problems on hexagonal pyramid for beta angle construction, similar type of problem may be there in the square pyramid. That you can understand. Instead of hexagon, we have the square pyramid. That's all. Not, there is no much difference. All procedure remains same. So when you come to the third question, you have the option between the development of solid and isometric projection. But development of solid, purpose of doing the development solid now is, once you understand some development, because I have covered all varieties of the problems from the development of solid, so that you should be more familiar with the projection of plane surface also, because when you're doing constructing cone, you have to construct circle, then the cone is also, it's a part of your the projection of solid. So that you'll understand better projection of solid as well as the plane. That's the purpose I started. As per our requirement is considered, you have to do some problems on the development of solids. You have to do some problems on sketchbook also, but I don't give any additional assignment from the development of solid. Whatever we have done in the classroom, those problems you do it in the sketchbook and try to do it in the solid software. That's sufficient. But isometric projection, I'm going in detail, but isometric projection we'll see after finishing the plane surfaces. I'm going for the isometric projection. I'm going in details. And one of the advantages of isometric projection means there are two solids. One solid is kept another over another solid. If there is a mistake in one solid, remaining part of the solid will get full marks. Imagine 30 marks. The top solid, you have done some mistake. Bottom solid will get marks. But when you come to your projection of plane surfaces or projection of solid surfaces, solids, if you do a small mistake in the initial position, the whole problem become wrong. That's why we should be very careful. So even if you go for a development of solid, it's slightly complex compared to isometric projection. Still, if at the end we'll get the time, we'll do some more problems on the solid, development of solid. But isometric, I'm going to do in detail. So today I'm going to, for timing, I'm going to stop this development of solid. So then I'm going to going for some of the problems from the plane surfaces. So now I'll go for so I'm going to do one problems on hexagonal pyramid. So hexagonal pyramid, it's also part of projection of solid, and it is also part of the projection of plane surface also. So it is a hexagonal pyramid. The bottom face is the hexagon. So is it PPT is visible now? Someone can answer. PPT?
No, sir.
No, okay. I hope now it is visible. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, in even development of solid also, you are studying again the basics of the plane surfaces as well as solid surface. So now you have the hexagonal pyramid. Just already you have discussed because I am doing one problem on hexagonal pyramid today. That's why I'm projecting the same thing once again. The bottom surface is hexagon. It's a hexagonal plane surface. So now if you keep this hexagon in this particular position, this is the corner position. So it is corner position is required for projection of plane surface also. Even we have there are three to four problems on hexagonal plane surface. There are some problems are solved for corner condition. Some problems are based on edge condition. So now this is the for the corner condition. The why it is corner condition is so if you rotate the complete pyramid to towards the right side, so then it will rest on the outer rightmost edge. The corner, hence it is the corner condition. So whenever whether it is a projection of plane surfaces or projection of solids, so if the hexagonal pyramid is resting on corner, if there is a resting on corner condition is given, you have to draw the top view in this way. In general, in a general explanation, if you say the two sides should be parallel to XY line, you have to construct the hexagon such a way that two lines should be. Two sides should be parallel to XY line, then it will satisfy the corner condition. That is when you come to the construction part of the pyramid. But if you go for the practical part of the pyramid, if you rotate the same hexagon to the right, you can imagine it will try to rest on the corner, the rightmost corner. Even if you try to rotate the complete the hexagonal pyramid towards left side, still it is resting on the it will rest on the corner of the base. So that's why it is referred as corner condition. Now if you when you come to pyramid, topmost point is apex of the pyramid. So then you can imagine one center of the center of the hexagon. We have center of the hexagon. So that will be that point is normally referred as O1. And topmost apex point is referred as O. So once you join the O and O1, that is the imaginary line joining apex of the pyramid with the base center of the base, that line is referred as axis of the pyramid. So even solids also you are showing the axis of the pyramid. So even when you construct in the hexagon, the initially you are going to construct the hexagon by circle method. Now when you come to hexagon, so even with respect to solids also, it may rest on the corner of the base edge, or it may rest on the slant edges. I am not only explaining the development of solid. I am explaining with respect to diagram, with respect to diagram, even solids also. There are cases. So you have to try to understand the basic concept. Don't worry about the number of problems, 50 problems or 30 problems or 40 problems. So once you understand the concept, then all problems become one problem to another problem. There may be slight difference. Your hexagonal pyramid may be rests on base corner, or it may rest on the slant edge. So now we can see edge 12. I think you can see the edge 12. You can see. I think this is the edge 12. The edge 12. I think you can see the edge 12. So if you try to rotate the complete hexagon, you can rotate such a way that complete edge 12 may rest on horizontal plane. Then it is the resting condition. It rests on the slant edge on horizontal plane. There are some problems on projection of solid. Your hexagonal pyramid may rest on the slant edge. In this case, either it may rest on slant edge 12 if you rotate towards the right side, or if you try to rotate the same pentagon, this hexagonal pyramid towards left side, it may rest on slant edge 7. So that means, again, whenever the solid is given for the slant edge condition, there are some problems in the solids. So where solid is resting on the slant edges, in such cases, you have to draw the top view for the corner condition. Then you can imagine, now only you can understand, if you try to rotate towards left, it will be rotated towards left such a way that complete it is rests on the horizontal plane. It will be rests on edge 7. If you try to rotate normally, you are rotating the solid towards the right side such that the head 12 should touches the horizontal plane. Only head 12 will touches the horizontal plane. In general, so whenever slant edge condition is given, whatever may be the type of pyramid, whenever slant edge condition is given, the whole, you have to draw the top view for the corner condition. This is the corner condition for hexagon when two sides are parallel to XY line. When you're talking about the construction part of the hexagon, so then it will be the corner condition. Then there are slant surfaces. There are some cases, so a solid, complete solid may rest on the slant surface. When you come to slant surfaces, this will not hold, this front end top will not hold good. This I'll see some more diagram for the slant surface. So now this is again the hexagonal pyramid. So now I told about the axis point. So the axis is the line, imaginary line joining apex of the pyramid with the center of the base hexagon. The base of the pyramid is hexagon. We have the center of the hexagon and apex point O, line joining apex of the point, imaginary line joining apex of the cone with the center of the base surface is nothing but apex. This is the apex. This is the axis line. This is the axis line. We can see the these are the slant surfaces. I think in the previous diagram also, you imagine this is the one slant surface. The one slant surface is formed by edge 3 and apex. The one more slant surface is formed by edge 5 and apex. So now this is the one more hexagonal pyramid. So in during the even in the solids also, in the second front view or top view, so you have to identify the hidden edges, hidden edges. So before identifying the hidden edges, you have to join outermost edges by thick and dark line. The outermost edges by thick and dark line. You can see here, these are the outermost. This is the left outermost edge. This is the right outermost edge. So when you're identifying the hidden lines, so don't worry about whether it's visible or invisible. Outermost edges you join by a thick and dark line. This is the outermost edge. So this is the outermost bottom edge. This is the outermost base edge. This is the outermost base edge. The remaining edges are invisible. That's why it is shown by dotted line or discontinuous line. So it is a, we have line segment. This is one segment and this is one more segment. The length of the each segment is the same. That is the indication of in the hidden line. Hidden lines are invisible lines. This is again for, if you draw the top view for the, this particular position in this way, this is again for the corner condition. Now this is the hexagonal pyramid. I'm talking about the, it may be rests on the edge surface, edge. So that means if you rotate the whole hexagon towards right, such a way that this come, such a way that this particular edge will touches the horizontal plane, that is the edge condition. I'm talking about the slant edge. So if there are some problems where pyramid is resting on the slant edge, it may be on the square pyramid or it may be hexagonal pyramid or it may be pentagonal pyramid. There is a one, few problems on resting on the slant edges. If it's rotated towards right side, so it will rest on the slant side. It is not a pentagonal pyramid. So it is a hexagon. This is not a hexagonal pyramid. It is a pentagonal pyramid. Why I've chosen is, if you rotate towards right side, so it rests on the outer rightmost edge. So now if you take the same, if you rotate the same towards left side, it will rest on the slant surfaces. We can imagine the shaded, the leftmost shaded surface, that is the slant surfaces. If you rotate towards left side, so it will become, it will become the surface condition. The whole solid may rest on the surface condition, surface on the slant surfaces. So when you come to hexagon, so when it is rests on the slant surfaces, you cannot draw the hexagon in this particular position. So instead of that, two sides should be perpendicular to XY line. You can, after finishing the class, you go through those, read all the problems and try to understand the conditions, especially hexagon. So you can differentiate one problem from the other problems, one top view from the other problems, one top view of the one problem from other problems. So when it is given as edge condition, so then these two sides should be perpendicular to XY line. It is for the edge condition. I am talking about the base edge. In some cases, it rests on the slant surfaces. For the slant surface also, two sides should be perpendicular to XY line. Now you are talking about the development. There are two types of solids. One is the frustum of the frustum, and one more is, I think, no. Before that, we'll go to the frustum. you are talking about the already you are familiar with the frustum. You have done one or two problems on the frustum. So here we have the pyramid. So we have one cutting plane. The cutting plane, I will show one more diagram. We have some more diagram is shown. What is cutting plane? So now, so you are talking about the cutting plane. Now this is a cone. Already you have done cutting plane for the frustum of cone. It is a frust cone. So now this is the cutting plane. Your most of the development of solid, you have seen, is saying that it's a cutting plane. So cutting plane is always perpendicular to VP. We can imagine it is like imagine you have ice cream cone. The cutting the ice cream cone horizontally with the knife. The plane of the knife is coinciding with this, the cutting plane. This is the cutting plane. You are cutting such a way that the cutting plane is perpendicular to the axis of the pyramid. The axis of the pyramid is nothing but the line joining apex of the pyramid with the base circle. It is nothing but a axis. So now cutting plane is perpendicular to the axis of the pyramid. It may be passes through the same midpoint of the axis or around 5 mm or 10 mm from the top apex, whatever it may be. But cutting plane is always perpendicular to vertical plane. So whether it may be inclined to horizontal plane or it may be parallel to horizontal plane. In this case, it is parallel to horizontal plane and it is perpendicular to the axis. Then we will get one solid that is nothing but the frustum. If the cutting plane is the parallel to the horizontal plane, then it will get the frustum. The frustum diagram, I'll show some more diagram. Now this is the frustum. The cutting plane is perpendicular to axis. So your top portion of the cone is removed. Then it is referred as a frustum of the cone. So frustum of the cone, because this we have a circle. This circle is also parallel to this circle. If in the case of frustum of cone, the truncated surface is always the circle itself. When the cut surface is always a circle. If it is truncated solid, already you have done some truncated. If the cutting plane is like this, your cutting plane will cut the cone in these directions. If you cut the cone in this direction, we don't get circle. We'll get some ellipse or some other shape. But for the frustum is considered. Frustum of cone is considered. The top surface is circle. Bottom surface is also circle. Already you have done one problem on frustum. Maybe I hope you are familiar with that. The same thing is sure. So when you come to cutting plane is perpendicular to axis. Already you have seen one cutting plane. The cutting plane is like the plane of the knife. So this is perpendicular to the axis. You can see here it's cut along this direction at a height. At a height h, this is just general example I have given. So then it is referred to the frustum. So in the case of frustum of pyramid, the top surface is hexagon, bottom surface is also hexagon. But in top surface, all sides are equal. If bottom surface is 40, the top surface may be around 20. All the edge length is also 20 mm. It is for the frustum. When come to truncated hexagon pyramid. Now this is a truncated. The still cutting plane is perpendicular to vertical plane. You can imagine this is the plane surface. It is perpendicular to vertical plane, but it is inclined to horizontal plane. When cutting plane is inclined to horizontal plane, then it is referred as a truncated pyramid. So you can see here. This is one more diagram. So now your cutting plane, imagine this is a shaded area, reddish shaded area, that is the cutting plane. This cutting plane is perpendicular to the axis. You can see this is the cutting plane, it is perpendicular to the axis and parallel to horizontal plane. Then it is referred as a frustum. Then it is referred as frustum. But this same cutting plane may be inclined. The cutting plane may be like this. In such cases, we don't get the circle here. You will get ellipse. So then set type of solids are referred as truncated solid. But in this case, cutting plane is perpendicular to the axis. Hence, it is referred as frustum. So now we can see here, this is a truncated hexagonal pyramid. The cutting plane is inclined to horizontal plane. Always the cutting plane is, in all solid, cutting plane is perpendicular to vertical plane. and it is inclined to horizontal plane, we don't get exact size. If this side is 40 mm, this side is 40 definitely, but this side may be 25 or 30 mm. But you don't get regular hexagon on the cutting plane for truncated hexagonal pyramid. You get hexagon shape, but all sides are not equal, but bottom sides are equal because already you have constructed the bottom side. All bottom sides are equal, but not top sides. Then it is about the truncated. You should be able to understand what is truncated, what is frustum. Now you have this is similar type of problem you are going to do. Now you first as usual you have to draw the top view. After drawing the top view, you have to draw the front view. So now this is your cutting plane. They are mentioned as A. This you have an inclined line. This is the cutting plane. So now once you cut, so we'll get one hexagon. It is not regular hexagon. All sides are not equal. But once you cut, bottom surface is hexagon, and this after once top portion is removed, so this plane is shown separately because it is not a line at all. So even when you're drawing the front view of the plane surfaces, you'll get line, but M, J, K, H, L, N, it is not a line, it is a plane surface. In this case, it is a hexagonal plane. This is perpendicular to vertical plane. We have they shown hexagonal plane. This is perpendicular to vertical plane. So once you cut, you'll get the shape like this. This is for understanding they have given. This is hexagon, bottom hexagon, ABCD or the ABCDEF for the bottom hexagon. Then after cutting this whole pyramid with cutting edge, so we'll get one more hexagon. So this is the one more hexagon, but not necessarily it is regular hexagon. All sides are not necessarily equal side. There may be some sides are longer, some sides are shorter. Then that is for the cutting. Now cutting is over. Top portion is cutting cut. Now, so you have to. So what you have to do is you have to develop the surface. After top portion is cut, now imagine you are cutting. You have hollow paper model of hexagon, the hexagonal pyramid. You cut top portion of the pyramid. Now you have to open the hexagonal pyramid. Imagine you are opening about NN. So imagine you are cutting from this point to, because bottom portion of the hexagon is already removed. You are cutting and opening from NA. You take one scissor. Imagine this is a hexagon paper model. Cut from N to A, then open it. So once you open it, you get this shape. This bottom portion is nothing but a development of the truncated hexagonal pyramid. You can see when you come to hexagonal pyramid, there are six inclined surface. You can see here, this is one. Imagine GAF is one inclined surface, GFE is one more inclined surface. Like that, there are six inclined surfaces. You can see here. You can see better here. So for edge 4, so it will forms one incline. You can imagine edge 4 is connected to the apex. That is the one inclined surface, or it is referred as slant surfaces. Those fundamentals are required for your the projection of solids also. Solid may rest on the slant surface. That is the one slant surface. From the edge 3, it forms one more edge 3 and apex. If you imagine the triangle formed by edge 3 and apex, it is one more inclined surface. Here there is one more inclined surface. In different, we will get six inclined surfaces. So now even development also will get six inclined surfaces or six triangular surface. We have slant surfaces for pyramid. Pyramid may be pentagonal pyramid or hexagonal pyramid or square pyramid or rectangular pyramid. The slant surfaces are always the triangle. Now, before that, I'll go one more problem. So imagine we have the pyramid, the complete pyramid. Imagine you are not cut. So if you open from this point to this point, so imagine this top portion is not removed. If top portion is not removed, if you open from, imagine you are opening from, take the, imagine we have a hollow paper model of hexagonal pyramid. The bottom is open. So already this bottom hexagon portion is removed. Imagine that portion is removed. In all development, you are removing that. So then if you open from this end to this end, so then we'll get this type, because there are six slant surfaces. this is one sand surface, this is one more sand surface front, one more sand surface. Similarly, backside there are three sand surfaces. Those three, six sand surfaces are triangular surface. Those triangular surface, you can see, once open, you open from a leftmost corner or leftmost slant edge or rightmost slant edge, once it is open, so then we'll get six slant surfaces. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The same thing, six, you can see. This is one slant surface. This is a triangle. Correspondingly, we'll get one triangle. So like that, we'll get six triangle. The same thing is shown here, but that we will get complete. This is, so you are not removed any portion of the hexagonal pyramid. As it is, you are open from the one slant edge. This is the development of full hexagonal pyramid. For development of full hexagon, don't worry about this part. This is used for some welding or soldering, etc. They are given extra piece for allowance. They are given. Don't worry about this part. It is not for required for your in the engineering drawing is considered, but it is required for the actual fabrication. This point may be required. So now, if you develop the hexagonal pyramid, development of hexagonal pyramid is nothing but, imagine we have paper model of hexagonal pyramid, bottom hexagon is removed, but if you cut from one either rightmost edge or right leftmost edge, so I'm talking about the slant edge, then it will open. If you open it on the book, like say a book or on the floor, so we'll get six hexagonal faces, one this triangular face. This is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All six triangular faces are nothing but all six triangular faces. This is one triangular face. This is one more triangular face. This is one more triangular face. Like that, behind also there are six triangular faces. Three triangular faces. There are six triangular faces. So once you open or once you go for development of the pyramid, hexagonal pyramid, we'll get six surfaces. But if you cut the with some inclination, you are already top portion is removed. So once its top portion is removed, still you should initially you have to draw six triangular faces. I'll tell you how to draw these six triangular faces. This is one triangular face. This is one more triangular face. This is one more triangular face. This is one more triangular face. There are six triangular faces are there. Before getting these points, first you have to draw six triangular faces. As per construction is concerned, normally I'm telling. So we know what is the length from the, you can measure the, imagine this is A to G length is known. Take radius, imagine mark at any point in your sketch sheet, draw one line. The length of the line is equal to GA, that outermost edge length, GA. Then with taking center at G, radius equal to A, draw one circle. You can see the circle here. We have already dotted circle. So that is only for the construction purpose, they have drawn one circle. So with center at G, the radius equal to GA, draw one circle. So after drawing the circle, take the length of base edge. Imagine already you have drawn the top view, AB length is known. So imagine length of the base edge is, let it be around 30 mm. So already you have the circle. Take the radius equal to 30 mm. So cut this semicircle or this arc. So we'll get one point, that will be B. You take with the same circle, one more point. These are nothing, AB, BC, CD, EF, EF, FA are nothing but a base edges. We can see here, AB, BC, CD, DE, EF. Those are the base edges. On this arc, you are marking the base circle. Then after marking, after getting the point A, B, C, D, E, F, etc., then join B with G, C with G, D with G, E with G, and F with B with G with light lines. Because the top portion is removed, once top portion is removed, this portion is already removed, cut and removed. Only bottom portion, this portion, you have to make it dark. That's why initially you have to draw with the light line. How to construct this line, I'll take one problem and I'll explain you, but at least you should know. So what is truncated hexagonal pyramid? In the case of truncated hexagonal pyramid, the cutting plane is inclined to the axis. So now this is a cutting plane, even though in the front view it looks like a straight line, but it is a plane. The same plane is shown in the exploded view. Normally this is the exploded view. It is you are seeing from this direction. Imagine you are seeing from this direction. Most of the time in our projection, you are talking with thinking, you are seeing from the front or top or side, but you are seeing from this direction. When you're seeing from this direction, you can see this hexagon. So after you have to, all conditions will be given. Your cutting plane maybe makes an angle 30 degree with the axis or 40 degree with the horizontal plane. Cutting plane maybe at some distance. All those things will be given in the data. Don't worry about it. First part you have to understand is what is the frustum of pyramid. The frustum of the pyramid is nothing but, so when you cut the pyramid with the cutting plane, which is parallel to horizontal plane or which is parallel to the base surface, then it is referred as frustum. If it is cut with the inclined plane like this, then it is referred as truncated pyramid. I think with knowing those basics, you are going to get this surface. Imagine already hexagon is cut, top portion is removed. So after removing the top portion, imagine your opening. Imagine we have one paper model, bottom hexagon is removed. We have the paper model. So take the scissor and cut from this point to this point. So once you cut from this point to this point, and if you open it, so then you'll get this surface. If you open it, this darkened, only this dark lines, only this portion you are getting, not this portion. So now we'll take one example. That is a problem number 28. In problem number 28, already you understood what is this. Hexagonal pyramid is given of side 35 mm and altitude 65 mm. Altitude is nothing but a height. Instead of saying height, they are given altitude is 65 mm. Is resting on HP. In most of the solid is resting on HP when you come to development. So this portion, initial front end top, is a part of your the development of solid, and this portion, this and this, it's also part of your plane surfaces. Once you understand initial front end top view, you are that is the fundamental for the plane surfaces as well as solid surfaces. That's why I have taken these, so that you can understand better some typical problems in the planes. Now you can understand better. After doing the solid, the plane surface will be easy for you. Some typical problems. And resting on HP on its base with two of the base sides perpendicular to VP. They are not given any resting condition, because when you come to development, so resting condition is not normal, they don't give, because you are not rotating the any solid, just you are cutting the solid, either top portion of the solid will be cut. That's why there is no resting condition, but then generally they will give one condition how to draw the hexagon. Once you draw the hexagon in this position, it is for the edge condition. So that means it is for the base edge condition. If you rotate towards left side, it will be resting on edge AF. That is a fundamental for your planes as well as solid also. If you rotate the same hexagon, this pyramid towards right side, it will be resting on edge CD. If you rotate by the O dash from this point to this point, it makes an angle. It is the edge condition. If you rotate completely, if O dash is lies on horizontal plane, suppose you are rotating the complete the front view such a way that O dash D dash is lies on horizontal plane. You are marking this as C dash D dash. If you rotate completely, then it will be resting on horizontal plane with slant surface. This is O, this is C and D. Slant surface in the case of pyramid is always the triangular surface. Already you have seen in many 3D diagram, then it will be resting on the slant surface. But in some cases, the slant edge O dash, C dash, D dash, even though it is looks like a straight line, but it is not a straight line. It is the triangular surface. O dash, C dash, D dash is a triangular surface. In the left side, A dash, F dash, O dash, it is again the triangular surface. So now if you draw the hexagonal pyramid in this particular position, for plane surface are considered, it is a edge condition. It is resting on the edge condition. If it is for the solid, either it may be edge condition or if the O dash is rotated such a way that if O dash is lies on XY line, then it will be the edge surface, sand surface condition. There are some problems in the solid. The complete solid is resting on the sand surface. So go through those problems, then now you can understand better, because already explained what is sand surfaces with 3D photos. So now you have cutting plane. I have seen cutting plane, I have shown many cutting plane, but cutting plane is always vertical to VP. That is other different. The pyramid is cut by a plane inclined at 30 degree to HP and perpendicular to VP. So cutting plane is always, as per your development of solid is considered, it is always perpendicular to VP, and it is intersecting the axis at 30 mm above the base. So this is the cutting plane. This is a cutting plane. It will intersect the axis at 30 mm above 30 mm above the base. Draw the projection of the remaining portion of the pyramid. So now I'll explain one point. The pyramid is cut by a plane inclined at 30 degree to HP. One condition is inclined at 30 degree to HP, and one more condition is perpendicular to VP. To understand that, I'll show one more diagram. So now you have the cutting plane. You have a rectangular plane. It is like a knife. Imagine it's a knife, cutting plane. The cutting plane is always perpendicular to vertical plane. This cutting plane is perpendicular to vertical plane. It is always perpendicular to vertical plane, irrespective of all problems in development of solid. Now it is horizontal. This cutting plane is horizontal. But in our problems, this cutting plane is, this rectangle is a cutting plane. It is not horizontal, or it is not parallel to HP. It makes angle, some angle with respect to horizontal plane. That means we have a cutting plane. You imagine you keep the knife parallel to the ground or parallel to the table surface. Now you are rotating the knife, which makes some angle. Imagine you have a rectangle, you are rotating the whole rectangle such a way that it makes some angle with respect to horizontal plane. Now I think now you can see, if you read this statement, the pyramid is cut by a plane inclined at 30 degree to HP. The plane is inclined 30 degree to HP and perpendicular to VP. Already you have seen on rectangle, that is a cutting plane. That particular cutting plane makes an angle 30 degree to HP, like this. So this cutting plane, I'm showing this cutting plane. Imagine this is a cutting plane. This makes an angle 30 degree to HP. This angle is 30 degree to HP. We can see this inclined cutting plane. This cutting plane makes an angle 30 degree to HP. We can see this inclined surface. After portion is removed, top portion is removed, so we have inclined surface. This inclination of this inclined surface is 30 degree to HP. Same thing is shown here. 30 degree to HP and perpendicular to VP as always. And it is intersecting the axis at 30 mm above the base. That means already, imagine you finish the front view, already you have done problems on solids, already you have done the front view. So after drawing the front view, this is the OE dash, this is the axis line. After marking the axis line, then draw an horizontal line at a height of 30 mm. Because axis is at a height at 30 mm above the base. Axis is 30 mm above the base. That's the first part. Then after drawing the horizontal plane, now about this point, intersection point, draw one line. So this particular line is 30 degree to HP. So whenever given 30 degree to HP, so you have to draw the cutting plane. This is a cutting plane. It is not a straight line. Don't think that already you have seen on rectangle. It is a cutting plane. So which makes an angle 30 degree to horizontal plane or horizontal line. What problem we have done in the previous class, where they have given inclination, where that particular cutting plane makes an angle with respect to axis. So whenever they are given angle with respect to axis, then instead of marking 30 degree here, you have to mark 30 degree here. So if you, once you mark 30 degree here, that indicate that cutting plane makes an angle 30 degree to axis. The previous problem, so where cutting plane inclination is given with respect to axis or with respect to vertical line. But in this case, the cutting plane inclination is given with respect to horizontal plane, that is 30 degree. That is the first part. So when you come to construction part is considered, As usual, you have to construct the this hexagon by circle method. First, you have to draw the circle with the radius equal to 35 mm, with the circle with radius equal to 35 mm. After drawing the circle with radius equal to 35 mm, you have to draw one vertical line. Already, you have done these problems in planes as well as the solid. Once again, I'll revising planes as well as solids. So, first, you have to draw the circle with radius equal to 35 mm. Draw one vertical line, after thin vertical line, or you can make it thick also. Then keep the center at this particular point with the same radius 35 mm. Draw an arc here. So once you cut the circle, that will be point D, and draw one more arc towards left side that will intersect the circle. Circle is not shown; it is just construction part. We'll get F. In the similar way, we have the point B with center at point B. The radius equal to 35 mm. Already we have one circle, so draw an arc towards left side. That arc will cut the circle or circumference of the circle. That point will be similarly draw one more arc on the right side. It will cut the circumference of the circle. That point will be C. That part already you have finished in the plane surface. After drawing this, then you have to complete the front view. Because complete solid is resting on the horizontal plane. Or complete plane, the hexagonal surface is rests on horizontal plane. You have to draw the corresponding front view. Because the complete solid is rests on horizontal plane, or your hexagonal plane surface is rests on horizontal plane. Hence, A dash, B dash, C dash, D dash, E dash, F dash, all point will get on horizontal line. It is almost similar to when point lies on horizontal plane, the front view of the point will get on XY line. It will get on XY line. So that means you have to finish the front view, because when you're viewing from this direction, A is visible, F is invisible. That you have to, F you have to keep it in the bracket, but you are not shown. There is some mistake here, but better to put invisible corners, because we are seeing from this direction, from the front. B is visible, E is invisible. You are seeing from the front, C is visible, D is invisible. That's why when you're seeing from this direction, you're looking from this direction. So C is visible, D is visible, but D you have to better to write within the bracket. So when after getting A dash and D dash point, draw one vertical line from the center of the hexagon, draw one vertical line, draw one thin horizontal line at a height of 65, because height or altitude is given. So that will be O dash. This will be the center of the circle, the base hexagon. Then, so join B dash, E dash with O, because we have the slant edges O, B, and as well as O, E. These are the slant edges. O, E, as well as O, B are the slant edges. Now you can imagine what are slant edges. So now this is O, B is one slant edge. O, A is one more slant edge. OB is one more slant edge. Like that, we have n number of slant edges. When you're seeing from the top, the OA is visible, OB is visible, because it's a distinct edge. Hence, in the top view of hexagon, top view of the hexagonal pyramid, you have to join O with all corner with thick and dark line. Now, OD is slant edge, OE is slant edge. In the similar way, OCD. It is a slant surface. OCD is a slant surface. Slant surface you can see here. Imagine this is OCD. Imagine this point is C, this point is D. So OCD is the slant surface. OA is slant edge. So OCD is a slant surface. That is in the top view, but in the front view, O dash, C dash, D dash is the slant surface. There's a one part. Now you finished your front view, then. So immediately we can draw the development of the complete hexagon. The development of the complete hexagon, it is very easy. So now at convenient location, at appropriate place in your drawing sheet, your sketchbook, mark O. After marking O, take radius equal to OA, that is the true length. The OA or OF, but not OA. But here, if you see this, can you get the true length here? We have one more concept. This is point is O. This point is A. This point, let it be OA. This is O and this is A. this OA makes or OD, D, let it be line DE. I'm talking about the line. I'm talking about the line DE, DA, which is makes an angle phi with vertical plane. Or if you keep the pencil inclined to vertical plane, you are keeping the pencil in the parallel to the vertical plane, parallel to the vertical plane, but it is inclined to this. You have, you can imagine now, AD, if you extend further, it will intersect the XY line. That angle is phi. That means you are keeping the pen or pencil such a way that the pen or pencil makes an angle phi with respect to vertical plane. So now, so AD is not parallel to XY line. Imagine AD is not parallel to XY line. Or so hence we don't get true length in the front view. It is almost like I given the same example I am giving with respect to shade of the stick. Imagine we have one 100 mm stick. You are keeping the stick exactly at 12 in the horizontally. Once you keep the stick exactly at 12 in the daytime, horizontally, the length of the stick is 100 mm. The length of the shade is also 100 mm. Then we can say that the length of the shade is nothing but a projected projection of the stick or projection of a line. So where projection of the length of the stick is also equal to projected length or true length. The top view length is also equal to the exact length of the stick. Same concept is applied here. But in this case, stick is not parallel to vertical plane. So stick is not parallel to vertical plane. You can see here AD, if we extend like this, if we extend like this, we'll get angle phi. Because of that angle phi, we don't get AD length as a true length. Because this is AD, once you project it onto the XY line, we don't get the true length. Those are the fundamental concept we studied in lines also. We have AD, so AD is inclined, makes an angle phi with respect to XY line. Hence, we don't get true length in the front view. A dash, D dash is not a true length. Then at the same time, imagine we have one line. I'm concentrating on, as per this diagram is considered, the OA. I'm concentrating only on OA. OA is the line which is not parallel to XY line or which is not parallel to vertical plane. You can see the diagram. Imagine we have OA. But if you consider rightmost edge, let it be C. OC is parallel to vertical plane, because you can see here, OC is parallel to vertical plane, but OA is not parallel to vertical plane, which makes some angle with respect to vertical plane. So if you draw the front view of the edge OA or OB.
Sir, could you explain again, please?
Okay, I'm explaining now. No one, just I'm giving on this. Do you have any doubt or shall I? I think I'll finish this, then I'll give the break.
Yes, sir.
You are, because I'm explaining once again, here you have some doubt, especially the true length. This is a new concept. Let's say you are extending the concept from the plane surface as well as line concept. If you want, tomorrow I'll put a similar type of line problem, one or two, I'll explain. Then you understand some of the concept is required for the planes as well as solids. Some concept of lines also you are using. I'll finish within 5 to 10 minutes. Afterwards, I'll give the break. So now you can imagine this. Imagine this point is O. You have definitely present point options. We have OA is a slant edge. This particular slant edge, forget about your slant edge, etc. Let it be line. We have OA line, so which makes an angle phi with respect to vertical plane. This that particular OA line is makes an angle phi with vertical plane. So when any line makes an angle phi with respect to vertical plane, so then in the front view you don't get true length. In simple way, even in you can test it afterwards also after finish the class. Take compass. Take the radius equal to AD, check whether AD matches with A dash, D dash. Very simple. When you come to physically to say that whether it's a true length or upper end length, AD is the true length. We are drawn with the true length. But A dash, D dash is not a true length. you can take the compass, you can measure even don't without constructing also, take in the primer test book, you can measure a dash d dash. A dash d dash length is not equal to ad. A dash d dash length is the upper end length, because ad is make some angle with respect to xy line. Or in simple way, I'm giving the same example of the shade, you can understand better. You are keeping the line on the horizontal plane or stick on the stick parallel to ground. So when stick is parallel to ground exactly at 12 noon, the dead time, the length will get the shade. The length of the shade is also equal to length of the stick. But instead of keeping it horizontal, if you slightly turn, if you make it some vertical, so makes an angle some 45 degree with respect to ground, etc., the length of the shade will slowly decreases. So instead of 100 mm, you may get 90 mm, 80 mm, because that particular stick makes an angle with respect to horizontal plane. Or simple way, when line is parallel to horizontal plane, then we'll get true length in the horizontal plane. When line is parallel to vertical plane, we'll get the true length in the vertical plane. But in this case, the line is not parallel to OA, the line is not parallel to vertical plane. Hence, we don't get true length. Or imagine they are done with respect to OC. So OC is also again makes an angle phi with respect to what the XY line. Already you are familiar with the angle phi. Because of that, we don't get true length. Your O dash C dash is not true length in the front view. Now, in final conclusion is, O dash C dash is not true length in the front view. To get the true length, you have to make the line parallel to XY line. With respect to same example, imagine you are keeping the stick. The length of the stick is 100 mm. It is already you are kept horizontally or parallel to ground. So now it is 100 mm. It's showing 100 mm length, and shade length is also 100 mm. If you slightly rotate, the shade length is let it be comes to 70 mm. But how to make shade length equal to 100 mm? Someone can suggest. You have kept the line, the stick inclined to ground. The actual length of the stick is 100 mm, but length of the shade is equal to 70 mm. How to make length of the shade is equal to 100 mm? Someone can answer. If you're able to answer to my that general question, then you can understand better. How to get? How to get the exact length? You understood my question, no? The length of the stick is 100 mm. It is inclined to horizontal plane. Now length of the shade is not 100 mm. The length of the shade is 75 mm. So how to get the length of the shade is equal to 100 mm? So you have to rotate the stick. Instead of the stick makes an angle phi theta with respect to horizontal plane, you have to rotate the stick. You have to keep the stick parallel to horizontal plane or parallel to ground. Once you keep the stick parallel to the ground, you are saying, because instead of saying a projected line, when those lines are parallel to etc., just I'm saying exact at 12 o'clock, 12 daytime, 12 noon. So when the complete stick is horizontal, the length of the shade is also equal to length of the stick. Now I have rotated by small angle theta, let it be rotated by 45 degree. Now length of the shade is, let it be 75 mm. But how to make length of the shade is equal to 100 mm is, again, you have to rotate it back. You have to keep it horizontal. So once you keep the stick horizontal, we'll get true length. You understood, no? That at least you can imagine that part. The complete graphics is based on complete engineering graphics, or CAD is based on those concepts only, whether it is you are doing the solids or plane surface, even isometric or development. Those are the basic concept. So still, I think tomorrow I'll do one or two few problems on the lines so that you can understand better about your solids, because I'll concentrate on those points. Huh? Otherwise, now with respect to this point, otherwise, I'll continue after giving the break. Otherwise,
it's okay, break, sir.
Now it is 3 o'clock.
Not at 3:30.
No, I cannot continue because after four, I have one more meeting. So 3:20.
3:20, sir.
3:20, I'll start. I have a plan to finish within four. After four, I have one more meeting, because as per schedule time is 3:45. hoping that we'll finish the classes at 3:45. All the staff members, they have, may have some meeting at 4 o'clock. Okay, 3:20 we'll start. And this some concept may not be able to understand, but tomorrow once again I'll do some basic problems of lines. I'll draw some, because those basic problems are not there in the primer textbook. I'll do some problems and I'll project it. I'll explain these concepts once again, because those are the fundamental concepts required for the planes as well as solid. If you don't understand, if in the examination, in the initial view, if you do small mistake, especially on the solids, you lose all 40 marks, all 40 or now. Out of 40, you may get end with 1 or 2 marks also. So there is a difficulty. Even for the projection of planes also, if the initial position is wrong, instead of corner condition, if you do the same problem with respect to edge condition, so then if it is for 30 marks, even though you are doing the spending half an hour for sketching, another half an hour for doing it on the system, even though everything is correct, but you don't get marks. Those kind of concepts are very important. We'll meet at 3:20, exactly at 3:20.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, welcome.